Thanks, everyone, for joining us. We have a very exciting forum group today, and the topic is the economics of climate change. My name is Mike Livermore. I'm the executive director of the Institute for Policy Integrity here. I'll just provide a brief sketch of the folks that you have up in front of us, we'll go ahead and get the conversation started. So the three speakers we have today represent three different perspectives on the question of the economics of climate change. We have an economist, we have a legal scholar, and a reporter. The first speaker will be Michael Greenstone. He's the 3M Professor of Environmental Economics at MIT and the director of the Hamilton Project at Brookings. He was, during the early years of the first year of the Obama administration, he was the chief economist of the Council of Economic Advisors. And Michael's work touches on a wide range of environmental economic issues. He's done important work on the Superfund program, on the relationship between environmental regulation and jobs. And while he was in government, he played an important role in an intergovernmental task force that was charged with coming up with a figure that would be used throughout government that examined the economic impact of climate change over the long run. On my left is Keith Johnson. He's a reporter with the Wall Street Journal. He's written extensively on energy and environmental issues over the years. One of the things that I think in recent time that was very interesting is he ran a blog on energy and environmental issues during the time that climate change legislation was kind of an actual reality in the United States, and he provided very close coverage of issues around there and continues to write on energy and environmental issues. And then Dick Stewart over on our left, the folks in the audience are very familiar with, of course. He's published extensively on a wide range of environmental law issues. Kind of most relevantly to the topic that we'll talk about today is a recent book, The Fuel Cycle to Nowhere, which looks at U.S. regulatory policy, and he's been extensively involved in environmental and climate change issues over the years. So with that brief introduction, we're going to go in kind of alphabetical order, and we'll start with Professor Greenstone.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to participate in this. So I think much to Michael's chagrin, I asked to do a few PowerPoints. I promise you there'll be no words. So this is just the economics of climate change in a few pictures. And hopefully you'll see a few things here that are new, and hopefully in the process they will help you think about the problem a little bit differently. So this is not new. This is just how temperatures have evolved since 1000 using a variety of data sources. You can think of it as kind of the famous Al Gore hockey stick graph. And so temperatures seem to have gone up. It seems to correspond with when CO2 concentrations went up. I think what is not as well appreciated is, and all that's projected to lead to a couple degree increase in average global temperatures, I think what is not as well appreciated is what that means kind of on a day-to-day basis. And so here, this is from some of my own research. I just downloaded data on daily predictions for average for temperatures, and this will be the daily average. So that's the not the max, but the average of the max and the minimum in a day. And the yellow bars, or lighter colored bars, are the distribution of days in the United States. So the way you would read that is there's about 75 days per year where the average American faces a temperature that's between 60 and 70 degrees. And you can see that that's the modal day or the most frequent day. And obviously, as you get colder from that or hotter, then there's fewer of those days. The red bars, let me just point out in respect to the light bars, there's almost no days a year, about one day on average, where a person in the United States experiences a day where the temperature is greater than 90. So again, that's the average of the high and the low. What the red bars show is, if you zoom to the end of the century and assume that there's no change in climate policy, or that there is no climate policy, I guess is a way to say that, then that tells you what would be projected to happen in the United States using kind of state-of-the-art climate models. And the kind of astonishing thing is that we would go from basically no days like that to more than 30 days for temperatures that are greater than 90 per year, and maybe 50 extra days in the 80 to 90 range. And so the reason all that's relevant is, I just want to bring home, like, you think of, well, the planet might increase by a couple degrees. The really important part of that, you know, if we had a few more 70 degree days instead of 68 degree days, that's not that big a deal. But what the climate scientists or their models are trying to say is that we'd have an enormous increase in the days at the very extremes of temperature. And that's where all the bad stuff is. That's where people die. That's where there's crop problems. And so this is just to kind of display the potential impacts of climate in a slightly different way. Another thing that I think is worth just reminding themselves of is it really is a global problem. So the U.S. could have whatever policy it had, and it's not, short of other countries participating, it's not going to appreciably change climate change. And this is just one way to illustrate that. The dotted line is the global atmospheric concentration of CO2, and then if the United States had enacted something like was talked about in either the 110th or 111th Congress, it just shows it would be a little bit lower, but not very much. And if you want to calibrate that, you know, the scientists think that we should be at 450. I guess some people think we should be at 350. I think, you know, 450 is long gone. Probably 550 might be a reasonable target. But at any rate, the point is lots of other countries are going to have to participate. And so I'm going to build to this. Here's one example from one, you know, there's many ways to distribute the responsibility for reducing emissions. Here's kind of a typical one, and this is for China. And this says here, the full line are their baseline emissions, so what they would be projected to do in a world where there was no climate policy. That's the full line. And then the dotted line is what they would be asked to do under kind of a standard assumption about how much they would have to reduce emissions if the world were shooting for 550 parts per million, which, again, I think many scientists would be quite uncomfortable with, but it at least might be feasible. And the only point I want to make is there's a huge gap between the full line and the dotted line. And so China, and you fill in other countries here, but India and a lot of fill in other countries who aren't rich currently, would be effectively being asked to undertake really dramatic changes in their emissions. And that will lead to the next slide, which is those dramatic changes in emissions are going to be extraordinarily expensive with the current set of technologies. And what this graph shows is the cost per producing a single kilowatt hour of electricity from a variety of different sources. And what you'll see is that coal looks like a great, enormous winner under this scenario. Again, this is just the cost of producing. It has nothing to do with how it's changing the climate. It has nothing to do with the health costs associated with using coal. But I think to a first approximation, the world basically chooses their energy this way, which is on the private cost. And what you can see from this is the low carbon alternatives are, depending on which one you choose, maybe 3 to 4 to 5 times as expensive. And so what we would be asking, the world would be asking China to do one way or another, is to fill in that gap, do things that are 3 to 4 to 5 times as more expensive. And I think the point that I want, one of the points that I want to get across is that's a big ask. And why is that a big ask? That's a big ask because China is not nearly as wealthy as the United States. It's not nearly as wealthy as other countries. And the same obviously goes for India. And here is one way to try to illustrate this. And this is from some of my own research. It's a little bit of a complicated graph. And I'll try and express it in English. But let's just focus on the full red line. What the full red line shows is if you take one day in India that is in the 22 to 24, and I'm switching to Celsius there, range, and shift it to greater than 36, which is a very hot day, but India has plenty of those days, and that would increase the annual mortality rate by almost 1 percentage point. And the dotted lines around it are just measures of statistical precision. Okay, so that's India. And then if you compare that to the blue line is the same exercise conducted in the United States. And what you can see is no one dies to first order in the United States when it's hot. No one dies to first order in the United States when it's cold. But they do in India. And the point of that is these countries, India and China and a lot of other developing countries, they have people dying today from completely, basically from low income. And to ask, what I want to illustrate is that it's a very big ask to say, hey, we want you to grow slower through using more expensive forms of energy, and in practice take on all this pain or, you know, damages to your society or increased mortality rates or whatever you want to call it today in exchange for something that's going to happen in the 21st century, at the end of the 21st century, or maybe the middle of the 21st century. And I think it just illustrates the complication. And I think one way that I think is really clear way to think about it is that the good state of the world for India and China is the world where they get to that blue line. And how do they get to that blue line? They grow like crazy. And they grow like crazy by using cheap energy sources. And they're desperate to get to that blue line. And the problem is that the good state of the world for them is the really crappy state of the world for us. Because that's the world, the way that they got to get to the blue line was by putting a lot of CO2 in the atmosphere. And that's and then we have full-on climate change. And so I think that may be one of the great challenges here. And so all of this is a long way of saying, I guess, that when I have a longer version of this talk, that I think there really are two main policy avenues that are worth exploring, I think, in the short run, or worth exploring. So we can all pray to the gods of cap and trade, and particularly a global cap and trade program, not just a U.S. one. That does not look especially likely in the next decade to me. And I think, to me, that makes it seem like what we should begin to do is think about how to adapt to climate change in a kind of serious way, and that we should also invest very seriously in the basic research that lowers that cost differential between energy sources that are associated with lots of greenhouse gas emissions and ones that are not very associated with that. So,
great. Thanks very much, Michael. We'll turn it over to Keith.
Let's see, I have to turn this thing on? Okay. I don't know if, I assume y'all are familiar with Pascal, Blaise Pascal. He had a wager with himself a while ago. You probably know all about Pascal's wager, but I like to think about this entire deal with taking action on climate and energy in terms of Pascal's wager, which in a nutshell was, you know, should I believe in God? Well, if I do and he exists, I'm golden. If I do and he doesn't exist, I'm not out that much, a couple Sundays. If I don't and he doesn't exist, no harm, no foul. If I don't believe in God and he does exist, I'm screwed. And the bottom line, it was kind of the foundation of modern game theory, because what it meant was he had the possibility for infinite gain or eternal happiness or whatever at the cost of essentially a few Sundays and better moral behavior and things. And his conclusion was you should always believe in God just in case. There's no real downside. And I think you can approach this, you know, sort of the business community's approach to energy and climate should kind of be seen through the same prism, in the sense that there may not be eternal happiness at the end, but there is definitely an upside, even if you don't believe. And this is the problem. A lot of the business community doesn't believe. A lot of the political community doesn't believe in those higher order impacts from climate change. Even if you don't believe in global warming, even if you think Al Gore's an idiot, if you don't believe in any of that, there's a few hundred billion dollars of reasons per year that you would want to change the energy system now, which is what I think businesses have grasped to a limited degree. I think they could grasp it more. I'll give you a couple of examples. A few years ago, a big report came out from the National Academy of Sciences on the hidden costs of energy. Basically, we burn oil for cars, we burn coal for electricity. $120 billion a year, per year, for the country. Health costs, environmental costs, some security costs. Another study came out, a little bit more controversial. The unreliable electricity grid costs $120 billion per year. Okay, you're at a quarter of a trillion now, per year, in costs from our current system. Some studies say the traffic jams, congestion, could add up to $80 billion in lost productivity, lost money for businesses a year. You're north of $300 billion a year now. Okay, if this was an Obama policy, we'd be hearing about it. $300 billion a year. Now, that doesn't even include national security costs. We talked about this earlier. $67 billion a year out of our Pentagon budget, according to RAND, is what it costs to secure oil lanes and oil supplies. Okay, the Fifth Fleet is out there, basically for one reason. That's a ballpark figure. You also have intangibles. It's a lot harder to deal with certain countries when you're dependent on their oil, and so on and so forth. So the bottom line is, you don't have to worry about dying polar bears and sinking ice and sinking Maldives and all of this in order to think that something could be changed. Some companies have made a lot of movement in recent years. The U.S. economy as a whole in the last few decades has become vastly more efficient. It takes about, I guess, half as much energy now to produce a dollar of GDP as it did during the energy shocks of the 70s, maybe even less. Some companies, surprising ones perhaps, are leaders in this because there's money to be made in doing things more efficiently, even if that means more efficient uses of energy or whatnot. Walmart is a really good example, actually, of a company that does well by being greedy. One of the interesting things about Walmart, they're so huge that anything they do, even tiny little incremental changes, add up to a lot for them. They're also big enough to tell people what to do. One thing they're doing now is telling their Chinese suppliers to clean up the way that they actually produce goods, or else they won't be on Walmart stores anymore. And the Chinese listen to them because that's a pretty big outlet. One thing they did a few years ago was tell their suppliers, not ask, but tell their suppliers to reduce the amount of packaging on every piece of crap that they made for them so that it would reduce the weight infinitesimally in their trucks. That infinitesimal weight reduction over their 10 million trucks and 10 gazillion miles a year added up to tens of millions of dollars in saved fuel costs. They put in LED lighting in their freezer aisles in all their super centers that light up now when you walk up to the ice cream door rather than lighting them with heat-emitting light all day long. That saves money. Smart stuff, simple stuff, saves energy, saves emissions, saves money. That's the sort of alignment that you can have in the business world. A lot of smart companies are out there doing it. Google has found a new way to cool its server farms without using air conditioning all day long. Simple, smart money cuts the bill. The big question for me has always been, and we've actually, Michael and I have talked about this, is why businesses don't do more. I think he's found in his studies that they do a pretty good amount. If there's money on the sidewalk, they'll bend over and pick it up. I think that there's still a lot of market distortions out there that don't align the incentives properly. And you can see this if you ever rented a house. You've never changed the windows, you've never put in insulation in the attic because it's not your house, you're going to move out in a year. The landlord's not going to do it because he's not paying the power bills. That's a market failure. That's why your house is drafty. Nobody's picking up the cost of it. And that happens in different ways throughout the entire economy. And when you don't have all the incentives aligned, sometimes businesses don't pick up the money that's lying out there. To move on just to the point of climate change, it's sort of a dead letter issue right now because there's no prospect of legislation. President Obama has stopped talking about it. But it's interesting, you were talking, Michael, about the Chinese graph, what we would be asking the Chinese to do. It's actually the flip side of that argument is essentially what sank climate legislation in the U.S., both from the business community's opposition and especially in the Senate. To this day, the Chamber of Commerce, which is kind of a nice proxy for the big business community, sort of their principle for accepting, action on climate change. They're not opposed in principle to action on climate change, but the fundamental starting point is that it has to be non-discriminatory. In other words, we're not going to cut emissions here and let the Chinese and the Indians and the Brazilians do business as usual because that's going to be higher costs on us, less competitive workers here, would hurt our manufacturing base, et cetera, et cetera. So that was also the rallying cry of the Senate Democrats, not Republicans, Senate Democrats from the Midwestern states, the Gang of Ten, who essentially torpedoed any chance of climate legislation in the Senate precisely because in their states unilateral climate legislation would have had a disproportionate effect. So it's kind of interesting. You mentioned the fact that the Chinese were asking them to do a big, you know, a big lift. If we don't ask them to do it, then the business community feels like we're asking them to do too much. So this is sort of the Gordian knot, basically, the entire global climate problem is, okay, we're in this mess because the rich countries spent a couple centuries burning coal and got rich, and now we're rich enough to be dancing around in Priuses and worried about the economy. These poor slobs are dying when it gets to be 35 degrees and drinking dirty water. It's not really fair to ask them now to pull a Warren Beatty. So what I would say is if you're looking for a way to sort of engage the business community on climate policy, I would actually think that the president's approach is not entirely silly, in the sense that stop talking about climate policy would be number one. And I would focus on things that would align the goals of climate policy, which would be fewer emissions and a smarter use of energy, with business goals, which would be more efficient use of energy and fatter bottom line in the end. And so I would think that you would want to find a policy that would create regulatory certainty far into the future so that we don't have new rules coming out every couple of years. Power plants last 50 to 60 years. It would be nice to know if the policies are going to be in place beyond next November, let alone for half a century. So regulatory certainty and a simple playing field that a business can say, okay, this is the framework I'm going to be working in. This will be my rate of return. This is how much it's going to cost me to do business. I can crunch the numbers, and here it is. You don't have to talk about climate change. You can talk about simple efficiency, health measures, whatever it is. You can still get to where you want to go. Just don't have to say you're going there. Because that sort of is the final point that I wanted to make, is this deal about the business relationship with regulation, environmental regulation and all. Despite a lot of the heat and fire that came out in Congress a couple years ago that still comes out today, business doesn't actually like too much regulation. Okay, that's true. Business really, really hates uncertainty, okay, more than regulation. And Jim Rogers is the chief executive of Duke Energy. It's one of the biggest power companies. And he coined a phrase, or at least popularized a phrase, which has now become cliche, but it pretty much sums up his attitude, which was, I want to have a seat at the table when we're discussing climate policy so that I don't end up on the menu. And basically that's the point, is if we're going to have regulation anyway, I want to help shape it, I want to know what it is, I want to be clear about when it's coming, I want to be clear about what it's going to do. And that's why, one way out of this might actually be to listen to some of the folks, like the head of ExxonMobil, who was actually asking for more taxes on his industry during this whole cap and trade debate a couple years ago. And he came out and he said, if I have my back against the wall, I would prefer to have a carbon tax, just a tax. Here's a dollar amount that we're going to have on your pollutants. You can know what it is. You put it in your spreadsheets. You figure out how to make money anyway. And the business community can deal with taxes, and that might be a way to get past some of the complications of cap and trade and the bad parts of Wall Street and the financial industry and derivatives and all of this, is simply try to figure out a way to put a tax on things that are bad for the country and the economy, and that way you can tax good things like labor even less. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Keith.
Thank you. Well, I want to build on, I think my colleagues on the panel have presented a good base here. I really like the idea of starting with Pascal's wager. And so what's the wagers we're facing in climate? We know warming has already started to happen as a result of human activities. And the best projections of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change says at current trends, if we don't have a strong climate policy, not only in the U.S. but worldwide, we're going to see significant warming, but in a great range of uncertainty. The uncertainty is we don't quite know what emissions are going to be, and we don't know what the sensitivity of the climate system is to various levels of increased emissions. So the projections can show increases over by the end of this century over 1990 levels of from something, you know, between 1 and 2%, edging up maybe to 1 to 2 degrees centigrade to up over 6 or 7 degrees centigrade. At the lower range, we could sort of handle at least in a rich developed country, the Indians and the Sub-Saharan Africa are going to have a lot more problems. There are important global distributional implications of warming. More of the adverse effects of drying, heat change are going to be visited on the developing countries, and the richer developed countries are also have more resiliency. They can invest more in adaptation. So we have a big range, and we say, well, at the lower end for the U.S., it won't be so bad. But the upper range could be a real disaster for everybody. So what do we do about that? The problem of the structure for the politician is you have to start spending substantial monies today to deal with the problem, because the climate system is like a bathtub. You fill it up with more emissions. There's a drain. There's a removal of greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, but carbon dioxide can stay up 100 years, maybe some particles are up there 1,000 years from now. So you're building up the bathtub, and it's rising at a faster level, much faster level, than the drain can drain it out. And to reverse that process, you've got to cut back dramatically on the faucet, that's the emissions, and allow the natural systems to adjust themselves. So because of inertias in the climate system, we're built in warming, sort of regardless, even if we turned off the faucet today. So what we're going to have to do is not only slow down the rate of emissions, but globally reduce them very substantially. And the longer you postpone trying to reduce emissions, the worse the consequences you're building up and the greater the effort to try to avoid those consequences by some drastic change in emissions, which are embedded, as said, in the energy system and a lot of practices throughout our society. So you'd say, well, it would be prudent in the face of this uncertainty and given the risk of really bad outcomes that is not trivial, really bad outcomes, we ought to start investing now. But the costs are going to have to be visited now, and the benefits at some point in the future, primarily. And of course, a lot of those benefits are going to accrue to developing countries. So this is a political problem of the first magnitude. And moreover, it's a global problem because all emissions from all countries mix in this global bathtub. And we could reduce our emissions substantially, and if China and India keep growing in the way they have been, and other developing countries, what we do won't matter that much. In fact, U.S. and European emissions have already stabilized more or less over the last 5 or 6 years for economic reasons in the U.S. and largely in Europe. The Europeans are committed to a 20% at least reduction in their greenhouse gas emissions, and they seem to be committed to that. But Indian or Chinese emissions increase 3 or 4 times over the next several decades, it's not going to, it won't contribute very much to solving the problem. On the other hand, to get the Chinese and the Indians and other developing, the Brazilians on board, the major developed countries, the Europeans, the U.S., Japan, are going to have to, as a political matter, to get agreement, do some serious measures to reduce emissions. The Europeans are there. The U.S. obviously is not. So what do we do about this? I was in the Bush 41 administration from 1989 to 91, where we were in the run-up to the Rio Climate Convention, where we foresaw the notion of a global cap and trade system. The advantage of a cap and trade system is globally, I think domestically there could be a lot to be said for taxes, But globally, you need to solve a distributional problem. You want the same carbon price on everybody, or the same greenhouse gas price. And that will, one, change the Michael's graph somewhat. I'd like to know what it would look like if he adds the social costs of carbon, and would help drive the search for the lowest cost alternative way of reducing emissions, whether it's efficiency, whether it's renewables, whether it's combined cycle gas and more gas discovery. Let the price system work by pricing the externality here, and let the market determine, with maybe some R&D help from the government, what the cheapest cost alternative is. But we don't have that price on carbon, and we have a lot of energy sources that have heavy subsidies. And the notion of a global cap and trade system is elusive, and a domestic one just as elusive. So what do we do? I think I'm with what Keith was suggesting, what we called back in the Bush 41 administration, a no regrets policy. What would we do if we just put climate concerns off the table? Of course, we keep them out of the corner of our eye, but we don't call them climate. So we already have a lot of regulation in the United States that's not labeled climate, that's already embedded in the Clean Air Act regulation of conventional pollutants, in energy efficiency standards, in the CAFE standards for automobiles. So we already have a lot of climate related, we have energy policy. We also have more explicit climate policy in California, REGI, regional initiatives, renewable energy portfolio standards in some states, and as a result of the Supreme Court decision in Massachusetts against EPA, we have EPA regulating climate emissions, CO2 emissions, under the Clean Air Act. So we don't have a neat picture, but we do have some tools that are in place. And as Keith says, what we do, I think, need some regulatory signals to industry that there are economic incentives now to do more, but we need some regulatory signals. And I think the trick is going to be how to gradually transform the hodgepodge of regulatory programs we now have to move towards a more coherent policy. So then finally, on the international scene, I put a lot of the blame on our current situation internationally, on Clinton and Gore, as well as Bush Jr., for giving the developing countries a free pass in the 90s and signing the Kyoto Protocol. That simply encouraged the developing countries to say, we're not going to do anything. You guys do it first, and then we'll see what we will do. And then that feeds into the hand of domestic opponents, as Keith said. Now, we have a breakthrough, at least in principle, in the recent conference of the parties in Durban just a couple of months ago, where basically China, India, Brazil, major developing countries agreed in principle that there would be negotiation of some sort of agreement with legal force, whatever that means, by 2020, which is a pretty distant horizon. But at least we seem to have gotten over the hump that the developing countries, which are the source of the major emissions growth, are going to have some role. And in the interim, I think we can maybe have this same building block strategy of cooperation, not on a comprehensive agreement, not on climate legislation, not on climate treaty, but particular ways of moving towards alternative energy supplies for energy security, among other grounds of interest to domestic governments, and on energy efficiency and reducing restrictions on trade and green technologies. I think there are a lot of step-by-step or building block, bottom-up approaches we can take, not only domestically, but internationally, and maybe pave the way for what will be a more enduring solution.
Well, thanks very much, Dick. We'll open the floor for questions. I'm going to take the privilege here of asking the first question. For Michael, you mentioned at the end of your talk the kind of, I think folks are focusing on the way forward because we seem to be in a pretty dire situation right now, of kind of government investment to bring down the differential between renewable technologies and fossil fuel technologies. So two questions. One's the obvious question, which is, you know, is the government particularly well suited to be making those kind of technological choices? Do you have a way in mind of, you know, getting away from the problem of picking technological winners, which is often raised against government support for technological development. And then the thing that I kind of always worry about with these technology-based hopes is that they might just not exist. It might just be that coal is a great technology. It is, and it's kind of, if it didn't kill people and cause climate change, it produces energy, you know, very inexpensively. It's pretty easy to use. There's a lot of it. And it just might not be the case that, you know, pulling electricity out of the from the sun is going to, no matter how much we invest in technology, will ever actually compete with coal. So I'm curious on your thoughts on those.
Yeah. So the first question is, the government suited to do R&D or to pick winners and losers and fill in your favorite kind of pejorative description? I think probably the answer is no, but in the way it's frequently done. But I think there is an important and vital role for the government participating in basic R&D. So that's a stage well before commercialization where we think firms can't appropriate all the benefits. Now, that, I must say, is not especially politically appealing as green jobs and things like that. It's probably for white-coated laboratory scientists much more than for middle-class workers. And so I think a lot of the policies, or some of the policies that we've pursued, have been much more focused on deployment and manufacturing of existing technologies. And I think that's probably not where the pot of gold is hidden. I think the pot of gold is probably hidden in some kind of scientific breakthrough that's hard for us to imagine right now. And then does the technology exist? Well, you know, I'm pretty sure it's always going to be more expensive to produce a kilowatt of hour of electricity from coal and then sequester it under the ground, the emissions under the ground. So, but I kind of think one thesis that I was trying to get across is I think I'm pretty skeptical that the day is near where China and India and fill in your favorite developing country is going to want to devote a lot of resources to doing this. Again, just to put a very fine point on it, people are dying today in those countries from low income. They're not dying in a couple decades. And so I think it's the best hope is to try and find a low-cost technology solution. I think that, you know, that very tension that in economic speak you would say the marginal utility of consumption, which is how much is an extra dollar worth to people, is just so much higher in China and India today than it is in developed countries. I don't think that tension can be escaped, no matter, there's no getting around that tension. And so the only path forward that I see in the somewhat near term is to reduce the cost.
Could I intervene on that to just observe, we do have a very, very successful instance of technology forcing with conventional pollutants from automobiles. The California Air Resources Board, by progressively lowering and keeping an eye on the industry, talking to the industry, what's achievable, has, you know, successfully over time driven emissions of conventional pollutants from auto engines and dramatically. And that's been followed by the U.S. and worldwide. So that's at least one instance where it can be done. Now, maybe you say the internal combustion engine is sort of locked into that, and we'll try and ratchet it down. But I want to ask Michael, is there no room for government measures for procurement of technology, let's say onshore wind, through feed-in tariffs or otherwise, to drive down the cost of the innovation at the applied stage?
You know, I think that's a very difficult question to answer. I think, you know, there's the old joke about solar, right? Which is that it's going to be cost competitive with the grid in 5 years, and that's always true.
Right.
I think I'm a little more, you know, with respect to wind, you know, it's not a new technology. It's been around since the 1950s. So I think personally in favor of a little bit more of the Hail Mary. Let me put a fine point on it. ARPA-E, which is held up as the great example of this kind of basic research and development, and it was started under Bush. I don't know if it was funded then, but was certainly funded by the Obama administration. And it's held up as a serious commitment, and it is. But what's astonishing is when you if you go with the principle that budgets are what you really mean and rhetoric is something else, you know, we fund it at $200 million a year or $300 million a year, but meanwhile we spend billions and billions of dollars on these deployment policies. So what are we serious about? I think we're serious about deployment.
Actually, if I could just pop in here, one thing is you asked about the government's ability to spur some of this. It's interesting because the biggest single energy consumer there is in the world is the U.S. Pentagon. It's about 1% of the entire U.S. energy consumption. So it by itself is a pretty juicy customer. And what's really interesting about the Pentagon is that they're clean energy fanatics. And a lot of people don't realize that because they think of it as a pretty staid conservative institution. They are all over alternative fuels, clean energy, efficiency, solar, wind, renewables, things like that. And it's interesting because it's not a story that's told that much. They are not tree huggers, by and large. They are not doing this for altruistic reasons. They are doing this to become more lethal and to lose fewer of their men in the field. Those are the two reasons that they do anything. I'm just going to give you an example before we talk about the government role for doing this. Just one simple thing. The guys today, just back up one second. In World War II, a soldier used the equivalent of 1 gallon of fuel per day. Okay, 1 gallon per soldier in the field per day. I mean, we didn't have that much. We had a few jeeps, a few tanks. Late Afghanistan, 22 gallons per soldier per day of fuel. Okay, so you have a more than 20-fold increase in energy consumption per soldier. The biggest problem for the grunts now, and jarheads and everybody else, is batteries. Okay, they all have GPSs, radios, two-way radios, fire control radios, this, that, map finders. 20% of their 100-pound packs is batteries. Okay, so these guys are coming back. A third of them come back with musculoskeletal disorders because of their overweighted packs. Well, 20% of that are batteries. They have to be recharged. They have to be airlifted in, airdropped in, bussed in, trucked in, whatever. The Marine Corps, which is supposed to be light, fast, and lethal, decided to send fold-up solar panels with these guys to the hottest part of Afghanistan, to Helmand Province. So they got these fold-up solar panels. They put them in their backpack. It worked. They were able to recharge all their gear, did not need any airdrops. They were able to get off the way, didn't need to be reliant on the logistical net, didn't need all the guys coming in with their fuel to power the generators, so they didn't have people dying on the convoys. The guys in the field absolutely loved it. They're ramping up the deployment of this. It's going to become standard operation for the Marine infantry companies in the field. That's Marine solar. The reason this is kind of interesting, it's not that one Marine infantry unit is going to create an industry. They don't go through that much gear. But what is interesting is the visibility and the long-term nature of these contracts. Okay, right now, federal procurement contracts for biofuels are limited to 5 years. One of the proposals on the table is to let the government buy biofuels contracts in 15-year batches. So you have these kind of sometimes startup companies that are brewing biofuels that have an uncertain future. It's kind of hard to get your financing if you only have a 5-year contract, but if you can go to them, to the bank, and say, I have a 15-year contract with the Pentagon to sell them oodles and oodles of fuel, their financing works, their economies of scale work, you scale up the refineries, you bring down your production costs. Okay, that's a direct example of how the Pentagon's involvement can bring down the costs. Then you have the multiplier effect. Okay, the Navy is using camelina biofuels for its F-18s, the jets and everything. They have put in thousands and thousands of hours testing biofuel effects on the engines of these high-performance fighters. You know who's really interested in that? The commercial airline industry. Because they don't have to do a damn thing. All they have to do is get these incredibly rigorous tests that are done in infinitely tougher conditions than what a 757 is going to have to do. All the heavy lifting is going to already be done for them, all the initial stuff, all the hard work, and they are going to be the inheritors of a much larger, much more robust biofuel system, and they're desperate to find a way to move away from oil since it's their biggest single operating cost. So those are just some examples of how the government, one particular part of the government, can actually do a lot in this sphere.
All right, so why don't we go ahead and turn it over to some questions. Do we have a microphone?
Yep.
Okay, great. Yep, go ahead.
Well, sorry. I have a few comments about what the presenters have said, especially for Professor Stewart. talking about the developing countries getting a free pass in the negotiations. Shouldn't we be more careful to, because when we talk about developing countries, we should understand that it's a huge group of countries, and actually most of those countries are not part of the problem. I mean, they are rather victims of the problems. It's only a few of them that pollute, mentioning China, India, and Brazil. So I think we should differentiate when we say that. The other thing is about China. When we look at the evolution of China's position regarding climate change and the efforts that they should make, couldn't we say that they are becoming more and more conscious of the problem and a little bit more willing to do their part to in efforts to solve the issue?
Thank you. You're quite right on the first point. The term developing countries includes, you know, over 140 countries or something with very great differences. And, you know, the real concern here are the biggest rapidly industrializing developing country economies. And, you know, I think what's envisaged in this Durban Declaration is that these are the countries that are going to have to join in the effort in some way. And there's still urgent needs in the countries that are most impacted, the small island states and some of the the least developed countries, for adaptation assistance that has got to come from the major polluter countries, and there have been undertakings to provide that. We don't see very much money flowing yet. I think in China, from my observation, they are sort of like Walmart. I mean, they're really concerned about energy efficiency and productive efficiency in general, and they have introduced some very strong measures to achieve that by making the evaluation of managers of state-owned enterprises, but also municipal and provincial officials, the party evaluation of these people that depend on their performance in cutting energy use. So there's a very strong signal. Now whether they're concerned, and I think they're also concerned about pollutants that have effects in China, the very, very serious, you know, air pollution problems. You know, whether they're really concerned about climate change globally, I tend to, you know, take Michael's view. They are experimenting with, you know, emissions trading, CO2. Whether, you know, they certainly are pushing a development of solar panels and wind, mainly for, you know, export reasons, export earnings. Now, that's interesting in itself, because they're betting that there's going to be a market for renewable technologies, and how much market will there be if there's not some greenhouse gas legislation or treaty in other countries. But I think they're mainly driven by economic concerns at this point.
On the China thing, I think we have the same view, but let me just add one fact. In Copenhagen, I think the Chinese promised to reduce their energy per unit of GDP by something like 40% to 45% between 2005 and 2020. If you took a graph of their energy per unit of GDP from 1990 to 2005 and extended that line from 2005 to 2020, which is something I've done, it turns out it's exactly 40 to 45%. So a cynical version of that would be that they promised to do exactly what they were going to do.
I have one other factoid I'd throw in here, which is I learned recently that Saudi Arabia is starting to invest substantially in renewable technologies. Why? Because they're now consuming 25% of their oil production, or 20 to 25% for domestic uses, and that's supposed to double in the next 20 to 25 years. OPEC production quotas are set by production, not exports. So this is very, very expensive for Saudi Arabia, and now they're seeing it purely on economic grounds to change their ways. So the market will work. I think the lesson is the externalities are sufficiently serious that we have to, go beyond, we have to give some regulatory or price signals in some way. How we get there is a question.
Yep, go ahead, Ben.
I have a question for Mr. Johnson about creating certainty in regulations. We've talked a lot about some of the uncertainties that are inherent in climate change, about the science, about what other countries will do. But I appreciate the need to create certainty for businesses over half a century or more. So how can we balance those uncertainties that I think are unavoidable with creating certainty for businesses?
Yeah, it's... I don't think for all the uncertainties you've got with the climate change, and again, you don't even need to buy into that at all in order to buy into these regulations, but you have certainty bands, okay? You know, you have the probabilities that something is going to happen. You know, you've got a very likely possibility that you're going to have temperature increases between 2.5 and 4.5 or whatever. So basically what you would do is work backwards from that and say, okay, chances are, sort of this is the no regrets deal, chances are in half a century from now we're going to be in a situation where you have massive pressure on coastal areas, massive pressure on agriculture, massive pressure on water supplies, blah, blah, blah. This is going to have this many costs, this many disruptions, it's going to lead to this much of a situation. The best way to remedy that is change in the intermix this, change in the transportation mix that. The most effective way to drive those changes is to put a price of carbon, say, at $21 a ton, for instance. Pick a number out of the air randomly. Whatever it's at. You know, it's at 10 euros right now in Europe, and it's not there, so it should have to be above 10 euros. Pick a number that is comfortable and that people can live with. Not so low as some of the preliminary numbers that came out in Waxman-Markey in 2009, which was a political compromise that would have actually probably delayed some investment. Pick a number that they can live with. If you have that in front of you that you can plug into your Excel, then they know what they have to do to keep their internal rate of return, 7, 8, 9%, whatever they need to make their numbers work. You know, it matters less the specificity of what it is than the fact that you have something in place over a 5, 10, 20 year period of time, and you don't have a situation like you're having with this particular political cycle where in November you could have potentially repeal of major structural regulatory changes to vast swaths of the economy. That's the last thing that the business community needs to see.
Yep. Dale, and then Al.
So this follows up a little on the gentleman's point about developing countries. Just the U.S.-China relationship is very complicated. I just want to make 2 points to further complicate it. I mean, one is just as the developing countries are many different kinds of things, so China is many different kinds of things. And we tend to focus on what is still, after all, a relatively small fraction of the population that consumes at global standards. Chinese per capita emissions are much lower than the United States or Europe. And in fact, there's about 160 million people in China who still don't have access to electricity. Okay, I mean, it's really important to remember that. The second thing is if you look at de facto climate change policies, the single most effective policy that's been undertaken in the last generation is China's one-child policy. Had that not been in place, Chinese emissions would be much, much, much higher than they are today. So another factor is that about 20 to 25% of Chinese emissions go to their export industries. How does one credit those emissions to the producers or to the consumers? Thank you.
You're right on all accounts. The accounting issue is an interesting one. Of course, if you have the EU system for trading and you have border carbon adjustments on embedded carbon, the Chinese should not complain, right? But I think they would.
Yeah, Al. We have a microphone there.
From a realpolitik point of view as opposed to a humanitarian point of view, what would be the best bargaining position for the developed countries for the next 8 years? In other words, assuming that the developing BRICS are not ready to come to the table until 2020, if we cut back now, pluck the low-hanging fruit, have we harmed our bargaining position in that for us to cut back equally with the BRICS, we've got to make some really hard cuts. Are we better off in a totality not making cuts until they're ready to come to the bargaining table?
I think we'll let Keith Johnson take that. That's a tough question.
Talking about the low-hanging fruit there, that's interesting. There's a now iconic McKinsey graph. You all have probably seen it. It pops up every now and again, and it sort of shows the steps you can take to, you know, to cut emissions or whatever. And like the first third of the damn thing is in net gain. You know, it's not that it doesn't cost you money; it makes money. And so I mean, that's not low-hanging fruit. That's stuff on your plate. This is the kind of stuff. I don't think that's going to, you know, change your leverage position later on if you say, you know, it's like holding a gun to your head and say, you know, I'm not going to do the intelligent thing and pick money up off the sidewalk right now, and that's going to make you a better negotiator in the future. So I absolutely think if you could fix the what I was saying before, some of the perverse incentives or disincentives or whatever, and pick that stuff up now, that's just a no-brainer for your economy as it is right now. Down the road, a lot of those things are going to shift along the curve anyway. I don't think sequestration of CO2 is going to become economical anytime soon, but renewable cost curves are coming down, biofuel, there's a million different things that are incrementally coming down, and over a decade's time, you know, 10 years ago we didn't have the iPhone, 12 years ago we didn't have the Google. So these are things that in a decade's time could be radically different. So I don't think it would harm you in any way to go out and grab what you can now and then see where you are in 10 years' time.
But I think just to follow up to your point, I think there's at least in principle a whole series of decisions that we could take that would be beneficial completely in the absence of climate being a problem. I think that's your point. And there's no reason not to take those. But the tricky thing is the extra decisions you would make just for climate reasons.
And one thing the Europeans did at one point was say, well, we're going to cut X, regardless of what anybody else does, but we'll do additional cuts if the rest of you guys agree, right? So you can make a sort of contingent offer in a way. Now, of course, the problem with our political system, how does an administration deliver on that?
Yeah, I
if
think
you've
in a got politics,
to get that through you know, Congress.
In a politics-free world, I think that's obviously the right thing to do. You just lay out, we'll do this, we'll do 2X, 3X, 4X.
And if you have, on the free trade agreements, we have a fast-track procedure in the Congress, but we don't have that for domestic regulation that would be involved here.
Question over there?
Yeah. So question for anyone, I guess. Under almost any scenario, the percentage of global emissions that are coming from the developing world are going to radically increase proportionally, disproportionately to population. So even if the U.S. and the rest of the OECD were to go the Hail Mary option and radically increase investment in sort of lower GHG intensity energy, how would we shift that technology? What's the role of technology transfer to the people who are going to be demanding the energy consumption for the next few decades?
Yeah, I think politically, it's just we're not going to send a lot of money to. It seems like a non-starter that we're going to send a lot of money to China and India to reduce emissions, and I think one potentially politically feasible way is through the development of new technologies. What the exact ownership, patenting, clauses that would facilitate the transfer of those technologies. I'm sure there's lots of people in this law school and other places who are good at negotiating those kinds of things.
So the one answer ideally would be a global emissions trading system that, you know, would basically you'd have private capital investing in reductions in developing countries, because the reductions, if we can get the reductions cheaper there and get the benefit of reduced warming, we get the benefit. And it doesn't matter whether it's invested here or there. And you can say, well, that's and then they would get regulatory credits that they could apply against their domestic regulations if we had a domestic regulatory system. And
wait,
yes, there's
can I interrupt that for 1 second? Yeah. I think that's exactly right for us to get our benefits, for our reductions. We can buy them more cheaply there, and that's great. But just the arithmetic of it all, they're still going to have to do extra reductions on their
own.
Yeah,
that's right.
And that will cost, unless we either transfer them money or transfer them permits, that's going to cost, a point I was trying to get across. It's going to cost a lot of money. I don't see us transferring that money to them.
I agree. And I think it has to be, in a way, the sort of seed money to get them started on, you know, low carbon paths to development. And so in the end, if the developing countries don't embrace this as in their interest, it's not going to happen, regardless of what the developed countries do. And that's going to depend on some technologies and some social and economic objectives, you know, so we can encourage and support that, but we're not running the show, and we can't afford to pay for it all. The other thing is there's going to be enormous private capital investment from developed countries in the energy infrastructure in developing countries. It's going to be huge, huge, huge investments. And can we sort of steer that at the margin in somewhat more climate benign ways, including through the risk reduction instruments from the International Finance Corporation, public-private hybrid financing arrangements with the World Bank, pairs with private capital. Are there ways at the margin to steer private capital investments in developing country, especially energy infrastructure, in a more climate-friendly direction? And, you know, how far does that go? And we get up to the price elements. But that's where I see we ought to be making a lot of emphasis in the near run.
I wanted to just weigh in on that for a second, because to one extent, I think it's a little bit misleading to sort of assume that these guys are out there without, you know, any technology and, you know, the developing countries. When you look in the last less than a decade, the massive shift in clean energy development, you know, now two of the top 10 global wind companies are Chinese, you know, and some of these companies were making, you know, widgets, literally just non-wind related things 9 years ago. They're now massive global suppliers. Some of that technology they actually developed at home. Same thing in solar, BYD, you know, electric cars, battery development. You know, they're not standing still. But what's really interesting, you know, you mentioned sort of the private sector money, joint ventures, JVs. Okay, you know who's crazy about the prospect of shale gas is the Chinese, because on paper they could have more shale gas than we do, and we're, you know, already the world's biggest gas supplier. So on paper, if they can solve a few issues, they might be sitting on a mother load of lower emissions energy. Now, they have a different geology. They don't have all of the technology and everything like that. They're buying up stakes in U.S. and Canadian shale ventures now. They're getting a lot of know-how, and they're forming joint ventures with Western companies who are desperate not only to have access to a massive market, but also just altruistically to help China develop a lower emissions fuel source for the future. So, you know, that's not a direct technology transfer. That's just the old-fashioned JV. You know, you team up and do business in a foreign country.
I have a question over here.
This is related to Mr. Johnson's assertion about sending the message in a regulatory or regulatory certainty. So how do you see not mentioning a climate agenda behind that regulation when, and this is related to a comment that was made before, when one of the considerations would be reducing CO2, and it's not really clear whether that affects human health and welfare. So there are uncertainty issues that are linked to a climate agenda, but that would have to justify necessarily a strict regulation coming from the government. And in relation to that, how do you see what EPA is doing when classifying CO2 or greenhouse gases, air pollutants? Do you see that as a problem, or do you see it as an opportunity to get that to a debate of a clear, coherent, comprehensive regulatory scheme?
No, when I was saying to sort of like not mention climate change, but to not focus it in that way, what I mean is there's a lot of other different ways that you can focus this rather than making it punitive. Okay, in the way that it was initially framed was, you know, this is a pollutant, these guys are doing bad things, you know, we're going to make you pay for it, and this is going to be the way the system's done. You can get a similar outcome if you say this is an energy inefficient process. We have to include this externality, you know, not necessarily carbon, but you know, mercury or toxins or particulates or air pollutants or whatever. I'm going to just give you an example. In 87, you guys were young, but ozone was a problem back then. Montreal Protocol formed to basically deal with, you know, CFCs, okay, not greenhouse gases per se. Massive success 2 years later, we get rid of the ozone problem. An unintended secondary side effect of the Montreal Protocol, which was not targeted at GHGs at all, is that it actually reduced greenhouse gas emissions by more than the Kyoto Protocol did. Okay? So what I'm saying is that you can come to the same outcome, an interesting outcome, without having to go through the front door. So you can frame it in a way that's more amenable to certain business interests and things like that. You know, an overall energy efficiency drive, domestic energy drive, a natural gas drive, whatever you want, you can get to a lower emissions mix. In terms of the EPA, wasn't their choice. It's a court order. They said the entire time during Waxman-Markey and then when it moved on to the Senate, you know, God help us, we're going to have to do this if the Senate doesn't move. You know, please, dear God, take up this legislation because we don't have the manpower to do this, and we're going to have to violate the actual letter of the Clean Air Act in order to invent some hokey tailoring rule which says we're going to arbitrarily regulate things that have emissions of, well, let's see, not your lawnmower, but, you know, 100,000 tons or 25,000 tons. So that's actually in violation of the Clean Air Act statute. They've had to twist themselves backwards to try to even figure out a way to implement this. This is not what they wanted. This was forced on them. It's obviously the least attractive option for every human being involved, from the EPA folks to the business community to the other than the lawyers, you know, who have to deal with all of this stuff. But it's really a suboptimal outcome.
I have a different view. I mean, the Supreme Court gave us this regulatory scheme in its decision. And just in the politics, this is now the law, right? And it's going to take a majority of both houses and the president's signature or the override of a veto to change it. And yes, it's not, the statute is not well adapted to deal with it, but it, you know, it is addressing carbon emissions. The tailoring rule is something we could have a sidebar conversation about. They're trying to make it workable. But the point is, it's putting some leverage against industry. And the hope is that if you ratchet that down, the industry eventually says, okay, we'd much rather have, rather than this welter of regulation, some fairly simple tax or other climate measure. So it's got a lot of warts in it, but it may be a essential political stepping stone to a more rational system.
Yeah. In the back.
Yeah, sure. Hi. You mentioned about the regulatory certainty, the carbon tax, and I think we can all agree that that's probably, from at least a policy perspective, the best option. But people seem to dismiss it off the bat because of political viability. So I don't know if anybody has any more optimistic view of the potential for a harmonized international carbon tax or that ever happening in our lifetime. But if you could just talk a little more about that.
I think we can actually, maybe this could be our last question, we can go through it. I wanted to add a small addendum to that of whether, just domestically, whether a carbon tax could be tied into worries about the long-term deficit and some kind of deal that had to do with deficit stealing.
Okay, so I think there actually is reason, I don't know anything about international harmonized carbon tax, that sounds like a bridge, very big bridge, but there's no question that we're going to have to do something about our fiscal situation. It's, you know, tremendous problems like that find a way of getting solved just because they have to get solved. And then at the end of the day, I think someone is going to have to say, would I rather tax things I really, really like income, or would I tax something that I think probably even people who are not big believers in climate science are at least indifferent to, which is carbon. And then there's a whole bunch of people who think carbon's bad. And so I have some, you know, reason to think that at the end of the day, when at the last moment faced between increasing income taxes or increasing the carbon tax or creating carbon tax, there might be, people might think that the political system might think the carbon tax is a better option.
Yeah, that's the real Hail Mary, right?
Okay, well, thanks very much, everybody.
I just say on the harmonized, I don't think there's going to be a harmonized global tax because China India are never going to agree to the same level. The idea of emissions trading is system is you give them more allowances. You meet the distributional objectives in that way. A tax only has one up or down. The allowances you can have the number of allowances in their allocation, and so you can maybe deal with the distributional issue in that way. Yeah. Sorry.
No, absolutely. Okay, well, thanks very much, everyone. Appreciate the panelists for joining us, and it's a very helpful conversation.